Arts Express, Asian Pacific Expression.
Community and cultural coverage.
Music and calendar.
New visions and voices.
Coming to you with an Asian Pacific Islander point of view.
It's time to get on board the Apex Express.
Good evening. You are tuned into Apex Express Radio. We are bringing you an Asian and Asian American view from the Bay Area and around the world. I'm your host, Paige Chung, and today is Acre Thursday, Asian American for Civil Rights and Equality. And tonight we're highlighting one of our 11 organizations, Viet Unity. Tonight we're going to talk about music, Vietnamese music, Viet Q music, Vietnamese American music, and just Vietnamese people listening to music. That's just what me and Thao get up to. Thao, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much, Paige. Hi, everyone. My name is Thao, and I'm an organizer with Viet Unity Bay Area. I focus on housing and food justice with elders in my community. Paige and I met over Zoom last year, and we just started talking about music and hella vibed on our similar experiences as Vietnamese Americans. So here we are today, ready to have a conversation and share with the listeners our experiences with music growing up and our relationship with it today. And thank you for having me here. I'm gonna pass it back to you, Paige.
Yeah, like I said, I'm the host for tonight. I'm also the program advocate at Asian American for Civil Rights and Equality. And I'm also a DJ. I go by DJ Mew. And I also write, and I'm involved with the Cutie Viet Cafe Collective as well. So lots of Viet love in the house. Yeah, I'm really excited to talk. I feel like we've been preparing for this and prepping a lot of different music we want to talk about for like many months. And so I'm really excited to talk about it. And yeah, I feel like our friendship was first a song suggestion and playlist recommendation. And Thao actually started our check-in with a music video. Do you want to talk a little bit about what this music video was about and maybe the name of it as well?
Yeah, we just watched by NTTQ or Wing Zheng Zhong Wong. And it was a really fun music video, 8 minutes long. I actually found out about this artist just this week. A friend of mine shared it with me. And it was full of plot twists and a lot of queer representation, and it was set as a period drama. So I don't know, it was really interesting to see this video coming from Vietnam and seeing just how, I guess, celebrated queerness is, at least in the music industry, since we're both in the US and California specifically, and I don't know so much about what goes on in Vietnam, but seeing this video, it was like, it was inspiring in many ways. Yeah. What did you think about the video, Paige?
I was curious. I don't know what period of Vietnam this is supposed to take place in, but I could get kind of the older, what do you think that is, like 1800s vibe?
I have no idea. I don't even know if that was historically accurate and how much of it was. Yeah, I don't even know. Definitely like ancient vibe, like when the men had like long hair, and it was like it was definitely like a set in like a palace drama kind of thing.
Yeah, because I was thinking, I was like, when was it last acceptable to have hair that long? Because immediately I assumed they were queer.
Yeah,
before all of the plot twists happens. We won't spoil the plot twist. You should really watch this music video. But yeah, the hair is really long. There's also like, it's a period drama, but it also has like fantastical vibes. I almost thought of Lord of the Rings a little bit, Lord of the Rings a little bit with the elves. I don't know if this was on purpose, but his ear, maybe this is his actual ear and I'm just like totally conning him, but his ear looked like slightly elvish, like Lord of the Rings.
I didn't see that. I didn't notice that. But yeah, they definitely had like light skin kind of makeup and like more feminine like makeup for the men. Yeah, so that was cool to see.
Yeah. And this is your second time watching him. This is my first. Because I had a lot of reactions to it because I was like, whoa, there's all these plot twists. But also the beginning is so beautiful. They have like really amazing dancing. Mm-hmm. And the music, the beginning of the song is my favorite.
Yeah, with the danga, or I think it's in the danga, sort of the two string instrument that one of the characters was playing. That was really cool. And I wish they incorporated that more throughout the song. It's definitely like a pop song. And yeah, definitely thought that it would be nice to see more elements of the very beginning throughout the song.
Yeah, so the beginning is a breakdown, like usually like in hip hop or rap or R&B, they'll have the breakdown right after the second chorus, and people will get their dance crew and just start like dancing. But in this video, they did it in the beginning, which really amped up the dramatic features of the storytelling too. Yeah. And also the danggo is like such a hard instrument to play, like just to begin with when you play it slow. And she's like playing it super intensely.
Yeah, I wonder if the person playing it actually was playing it or knows how to play it. That's something I want to know, because this it really reminded me of that other song by Limebox, Yu Niao. I don't know if I showed that to you. It was the one where she had the, I don't know what it's called, but it's like the bigger instrument that has a lot of strings and you have to wear finger things to play it.
Yes.
And they incorporate like beatboxing and stuff like throughout the whole entire song. And yeah, I thought, and that's more like indie than pop. And they're like taking like a classical Vietnamese song and twisting it with like instrumentals and also visuals too. I just really like the music that's coming out of Vietnam right now, that especially the ones that incorporate more traditional instruments and dance.
Yeah, it feels like a little bit of a remix or a callback. There's also another person I've been seeing on Instagram that is playing also that same instrument where the strings are laid out flat, or not flat, it's like on a curve. I don't know what it's called either. Mm-hmm. She also has a drum machine and she'll do it to like hip hop. So she has a Wu-Tang one, she has like a Biggie one, and she's like playing the beats and then also playing the instrument, the Vietnamese instrument.
Wow, that's super cool.
Yeah, it's really fun. Yeah, it's pretty gangster. Thao, what was your first memory of music?
My first memory of music, it was definitely probably watching Paris by Night or something similar with my parents, probably in our living room. Yeah, I think it was either that, or I grew up watching a lot of period actions, like wuxias, which is like ancient Chinese like series that has like martial arts and stuff like that, and like listening to the opening of each episode. And I think those were two of my earliest memories of music. And yeah, I think when I think about like my journey through music as like an American too, I don't think I really understood or was exposed really or knew what American music was until like junior high. Like I think everything before that was just like Vietnamese and Cantonese music, because my parents don't really listen to American music much. So yeah, my first memory would have to be like Paris by Night or like some Cantonese pop song. What about you? What was your first memory of music?
Yeah. What was my first memory of music? Let me think. Yeah, I want to say like my parents and I lived in Puerto Rico when I was really little. So I have a lot of memories of like my mom playing music in the house and a lot of Madonna, a lot of Sade. She was really into Gypsy Kings when I was little. I think probably influenced by living in Puerto Rico. And then also living in Puerto Rico, I listened to a lot of reggaeton at the time, because it was just like, I was just like constantly playing the streets. People would be like, oh, do you know reggaeton? I'm like, yeah, up until 2010. It drops off after 2010. So if you ask me about like Bad Bunny or anyone more recent, I don't know anything of their music. But so yeah, like all of that. And then also similar, like I watched a lot of Paris by Night growing up too with my grandmother, and we would watch it in the living room. And yeah, we would spend a lot of time in the living room just sitting together and watching it and talking. They didn't really pay attention, it felt like. It was just like on. Did you guys like fully give it your attention when you'd watch it? Or
I would say so. I think my parents definitely, they would really pay attention to the parts where the MCs were introducing the song and the writer. Like they would be really into those parts where it's like a little bit of history about who wrote this song, a tribute to those people. So they really liked that. And there were songs that they would skip too, where they're like, I don't like this song or whatever, and they would just skip it. Yeah, so I guess they did pay attention. And there were times, I mean, sometimes like, I really liked a song and it would come on like these DVDs that obviously some uncle like ripped onto the DVD and would give to my dad, and I would keep track of like, oh, I really like that song. And then I would like on my own time pop it into the DVD player and find that song.
So, oh wow, you didn't even have a CD player. You had to pull it up on the DVD.
Yeah, it was all DVD. It was
all DVD.
Yeah. But I also wanted to go back to like when you talked about growing up in Puerto Rico, and you said that you watched Paris by Night with your grandma. What about like your parents? Did they watch Paris by Night, or was it mostly, were they more like into American music?
Yeah, my parents, sorry, I thought I said that too. Thanks for asking. That would be like me, my parents, my grandma, my sister usually sometimes. And then, because my house is crazy, like people are just constantly in and out of it and like living in it. So sometimes I have all these aunties living in it or nobody in it. So depending on what year it was, we would all sit and watch it together. But my grandma listened to a lot of Vietnamese music. And then she would also just listen to whatever my mom gave her. She recently passed away, so I took all of her CDs. But I realized all of her CDs are actually just like my mom's CDs. But yeah, we watched it all together. And I think they actually also, my parents and my grandmother, went to go see Paris by Night in Vegas one year.
Oh, wow. I hella want to go to a Paris by Night show.
But they have a new hostess, right? The woman changed.
Oh, really?
Like, I think so, because I feel like I saw recent ones. And I was like, oh, like, where's the woman that I saw growing up? What's her name?
Wing Kao Ki Ying. Yeah.
Yeah, I think they replaced her with someone younger.
is the Wing Kao Nyang, the guy, is this still the same dude?
Yes, that's why I was like, what happened to her? She, like, is iconic.
Yeah. But I would totally go to a show. I, like, was thinking about maybe I should look up. Because I've been to hella concerts, and I'm just like, why haven't I gone to Paris by Night? And I know from what I hear, they like lip sync and that's like the production.
Yeah.
But I would still go. Like,
well, I feel like I really want to go see the plays. Like the plays are really good. Like, dude, Paris by Night is, okay, so for our listeners who don't know anything about Vietnamese culture or just don't know what this is, Paris by Night is, I guess, Vietnamese Grammys, but like we don't have awards. It's just like a whole night of music, of like live, quote unquote, live performances that are lip sunk. And then also there's like an entire play in the middle of it. So 3 hours long. But I feel like that's really long considering like there's so many performances.
Yeah.
And it's put on in the US and usually I think California, if I'm correct.
Yeah.
By like Viet Q, probably like our parents' generation.
It started off in Paris though. That's why it's probably called Paris by Night.
Wait, but it started in Paris?
Yeah, in 1983. By an immigrant named Thao Vung Lai.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought it was just like, I don't know what it was, why they picked Paris. Yeah.
Because there were a lot of refugees to Paris, or immigrants and refugees to Paris from Vietnam. But it moved to Orange County, California, like pretty soon after. But yeah, the plays are really interesting. And usually they'll talk about the artist who wrote the song or came up with the words for the song. Then there are skits, which I don't know about you, but I felt like growing up, the skits, like sometimes they were like interesting and good, but sometimes they were like homophobic or transphobic. Yeah, that's something that I was uncomfortable with at times. But what something else interesting about Paris by Night is just the range of music that comes on there. Like they have all kinds of stuff from like our wartime music to what I didn't know at the time, but like covers of like international pop songs that were from other countries. Like I remember there was this whole, it wasn't Paris by Night, it was Asia. There's like Paris by Night, Asia, Vung Sung. There's a couple different kinds of these shows. But they did this one episode where the theme was music from other countries that they covered in Vietnamese. And that was one of my favorites. Yeah. Yeah, it was just cool because just to see the style change up a little. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I have quite as accurate of a memory as you, because you're like, oh, I remember this, I remember that. And then I was like, I have vague memories of them. And I don't remember the skits enough to remember how they're homophobic and transphobic. And yeah, it made you feel uncomfortable.
We should go to a show, though.
Yes, let's do it. Yes, I would totally go to a show with you.
Maybe things have changed. But yeah, that kind of like the juxtaposition of like Vietnamese American music versus, well, not versus, but next to like music from Vietnam, which is like the music video we just watched, where like queerness is very celebrated, and then like Vietnamese American, it's like queerness is made fun of or is like a joke. So it's interesting.
I wonder if it's also maybe more about like the generation of people who are creating this music or creating these shows, because Paris by Night is like a little bit of the older generation, like the first wave of the refugees, and maybe a little bit of the second wave as well. But the queer music video we just saw is very, like, seems like a very young person.
Yeah.
Like, more like our generation. I feel like our generation in general is just very open about queerness.
Yeah. And that makes me think, too, what would it look like for shows like Paris by Night to have more young folks be running the show? And I feel like that might make the elders uncomfortable. Like, an experience I sometimes have, and I don't know how accurate this is, it's just like a feeling that I have, where with the whole, the way that it relates to the Vietnam War, and like, I feel like my mom only likes old music. Like, she doesn't really listen to anything really new anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I feel like she has this thought that, oh, music from the past is better, and because it's like from a better time. And so I wonder like how that plays into whether or not there would be more space for younger people or younger culture to be present in these shows like Paris by Night.
How old is your mom, if I can ask?
She was born in 1961.
Oh, okay. So I think she's probably like close to my dad's age.
Yeah. What about your parents in terms of the music they listen to? I remember you mentioned to me once that they listen to new wave music.
Oh, yeah. I think it's really interesting that your mom listens to only like the old, I'm assuming the wartime music. I think my dad can be like that too, but I think he has a really strong nostalgia for American rock music. That's like the really soft rock. That's like the Beatles era. I didn't know this, but I think it was when my girlfriend came over and then she was like, oh, let's all sing together in the living room. I don't even know how she got people to do that. But then she was like, okay, what songs do you guys want to sing? And then my dad was naming all this music I had never heard of. It's just like Beatles era music. And then she was just playing the guitar. And my mom knew all that music too. It was really interesting. So I think it's like soft rock. And my dad likes a lot of old French music. I think a lot of like older Vietnamese people would probably know about. He's always playing this one French album on repeat.
You said your dad listens to a lot of French music.
Yeah, and my mom has a really different relationship to music, I think, because she was a lot younger when she came to the US. I think she was like 12 or 13 already. So she has a lot of influence by like the new wave era of music. So a lot of Vietnamese, there's a movie about this. Okay, so there's this filmmaker named Elizabeth I. She's making this documentary about new wave. It's like everything that my mom experienced. It's the 1980s, like all these Vietnamese kids are in Orange County. They're listening to all this music that's like kind of European abroad music that's also like slightly techno, and they're just like partying a lot. They're like, it's so 80s. Their hair is huge. Their eyebrows are super thick. So my mom was like really into that. And my mom, I think, listens to a lot of American music, or just she's super into music. Like, she will dig for new music all the time. Like, she'll sit on her phone and listen to new songs. So I think she has a really strong relationship to music. Yeah,
that sounds great. Yeah, I guess the younger generation is like more open to things, maybe because, yeah, we don't know why.
Yeah, because how old was your mom when she came to the US? Because my dad was a little older. He was like 16 or 17.
Yeah, same, like 16, 17.
Yeah, I think those years are really different.
Yeah. I mean, if we think about if we had to leave our country and feel like we lost it at that age, like, I'm sure it'd be a strong reason why we would feel attached. But the interesting thing to me, like when you brought up how like your dad likes the Beatles, I was in the car once with one of my friends and she started playing a song and I recognized it and I was like, wait, I know the Vietnamese version of this song. And it was a Beatles song. I was like, what song is this? And it was like the Beatles. And I was
Vietnamese
version of this song. But I didn't know that the Vietnamese version was a cover. And that kind of led me down like later on throughout my life. Even now, I'm like, I made this playlist for myself and for my mom for one of her favorite Vietnamese singers, Vũ Khanh. And then the same songs by Julio Iglesias, which is, and I guess maybe some people, older folks might know who Julio Iglesias is, but for younger folks, he's Enrique Iglesias's dad.
I think my parents talked about him the other night. Yeah.
He's like a huge international hit. And so many of his songs are covered in other languages. And a lot of Vietnamese songs are Julio Iglesias covers. But I don't, like, when I was listening to the Vietnamese version, I didn't know that. And there was this other time where when I was like an intern for a labor union, and there was these older Latino women, and they showed me Abrazame by Julio Iglesias. And I was like, I know this song, the Vietnamese version. It's just like Lai Gung Hong. Yeah, there's just, I feel like it's interesting when there's such a nostalgia for Vietnam for the older generation. Yet a lot of, a good chunk of the music they listen to is covers from other countries. So it is Vietnamese music, but it has like an origin from somewhere else. And I don't know if they talk about that. I guess they know. I don't know if they know. It's just like an interesting situation.
When we were in Vietnam, I remember talking to my mom about, we were talking about the beauty, so not necessarily like the musical influences, but she was like, oh, like the women here, they just want to look like Korean women. I don't know if that's a stereotype. I don't really know what that means. If that's offensive, I'll totally take responsibility for that. But I was just thinking about that because I think Vietnam is easily discussed as a place that's been influenced, but not necessarily as a place that creates their own culture or is has like ownership over their own culture. And what does it mean to have only covers or like mostly covers of like international songs? What does it mean to be part of a diaspora that's using music from another diaspora? And I think, yeah, it just reminds me of how interconnected the global experience is. I think people really, I don't know, yeah, don't talk about that as much.
Yeah, it's so interesting to me. I actually got into a sort of mini argument with my mom about this because I was talking to a group of Latinx folks in San Jose about engaging with the Vietnamese community. And like I mentioned that there's a lot of music we listen to that are the same, like not all of it, of course, but like a handful of things. And I was talking to my mom about this, and both cultures share a history of colonization. And that's part of the what influences the music. And my mom got really mad at me when I said that. And she was like, no, it's not because we're colonized. It's because we just cover music that's good. And I'm like, do you cover music from non-European countries or like non-Japanese music, which also they colonized Vietnam for, or invaded and occupied Vietnam for a bit. And I was like, do y'all sing music from like non-European or non-Japanese? Because I don't hear any of that. And because if her argument is because it's good, so that's why we cover it, then are you saying like other parts of the world don't have good music? So I don't know. And I think, yeah, I think it hit kind of a spot for her. But I remember watching this documentary about Cambodian music from like the 70s, 60s and 70s. It was a documentary called Don't Think I've Forgotten. And how they mentioned how a lot of Cambodian rock bands were covering rock music from the United States. But their thing wasn't like, oh, I'm here to mimic it. Their whole thing was like, look, we can play the song, but do it better. Their mindset going in. So it's, I'm guessing like, maybe it's not just like part of it. Yeah, I think is definitely influenced by some sort of imperialism, cultural imperialism. But I think also part of it too is like we have to recognize the agency of folks who are making these covers. Because I do sometimes listen to the Beatles' I Love Her and then the Vietnamese version by Vũ Khanh, which is, I think it's Vang Mai You Am or something like that. And I like the Vũ Khanh version better. I think the Beatles one is basic because the lyrics are so basic.
Oh, wait, what is it called?
And I Love Her is Beatles. And in Vietnamese, it's Vang Mai You Am. And I think the lyrics for the Vietnamese one is so much more deep and poetic.
Aww.
And so I think like, some of the covers actually make the song better. And I think we also have to recognize that too.
You're tuned into Apex Express on 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley and online at kpfa.org.
Let me just introduce this song. This song is called Noi Buong Hoa Phuong, which is a song which is really old. It's like from, I think, the 20s, 40s, 60s. I'm not sure, but it's really old. And it's a bolero for it's like a tribute to all of our elders out there. They know exactly every word, so I'm gonna try to remember all the words. Yeah, cool. Thank you. So ready for Noi Buong Hoa Phuong. Woo! chứa chan tình thương. Ngày mai xa cánh hai đứa hai nơi, phố gần gũi nhau mà rồi, ta từ là hết người ơi. Tìm về nước nào buồn hơn tiếng lòng, cảm thầm được nỗi vắng xa người thương. Màu hoa vương thắm như máu con tim, mỗi lần em thêm kỷ niệm, người xưa biết đâu mà tìm. Giá biết bạn lòng ơi, thôi nay xa cách
tuned into Apex Express on 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley and online at kpfa.org.
I think so, two things. So like the first thing about your mom being defensive, I feel like that's really interesting. Like sometimes I'll get into conversations with my parents and there's all these little edges of we'll talk about something and then suddenly they're defensive. And I don't think it's ever about the thing itself. It's about something else that's being unsaid. So I'm always curious about those edges for us as we speak to our parents, because I just wonder about what your mom is really upset about. And then I think the other thing is my mentor was talking about this recently, because you and I have, and I think our generation has a language about, oh, this song is a cover of another song. But then in the 80s, there's many versions of that song, but they don't call it covers. They call it Lauryn Hill's and then the name of the song or the artist and the name of the song. But it's not, oh, this person covered it from someone else. So it has some ownership to the song and their version of it. Whereas like a cover is this person was the original person who made the song, like the Beatles, it's their song. But Vukan like also has made a cover of it. I just wonder about how people take ownership of a song and what people call it and language around stuff like that.
Yeah. Like when people talk about other forms of art, usually like there's this understanding that you have multiple inspirations and like streams of influence, and how like things like they do belong to someone, but it also comes from so many places. It's interesting to put music into that perspective too, because obviously like the Beatles didn't do everything themselves, and like it wouldn't be so popular, at least in Vietnam, if other people weren't doing their version of it.
And I don't know what's more accurate or what's the language we're using, but just to think about like how we say things, because now we're in this point, a lot of people in culture where people are constantly talking about ownership in a way that does not allow for many other definitions of ownership.
I think at least recognizing the history of a song is really important. But Because going back to our parents, at least the ones who came here when they were older and have that nostalgia, they cling to that. And I think there's this sense of attachment to the nation, or like a nation that doesn't exist anymore. And that is their kind of way of trying to feel ownership over something. Oh yeah, because when I showed my mom that like this one Wukan song is also sung by Julio Iglesias, and she's, but did Julio write it? Who wrote it? What's the country of origin?
You know? Oh.
Yeah, and I was like, no, actually it's from Julio Iglesias. I was like so shocked by that. But yeah, I guess for those who are listening and don't know about this, like once the war ended in Vietnam and the communist like state took over and won, they banned a lot of music. And so there's two main categories. There's like red music, which they called music that is pro-revolution and war-y. And then there's like yellow music, which they banned. And yellow music is music from other countries, in a sense, music that Vietnamese folks did what we call covers of, or music influenced by, has Western influences in it. And they banned all of that because they said that it was anti-revolutionary. And it wasn't just the communists that banned music. Also, like the South Vietnam, back in the day, they did ban a song that was talking about the Cham folks who Southern Vietnam stole their land and took everything from them. And there was a song that came out of that group, and it was being sung, and that was banned by South Vietnam. So there's a lot of banning of music. But I guess my point is, like, I think that's probably what maybe I was touching on when I got my mom kind of frustrated, because she wanted to see that she didn't want the music she listened to be called, she didn't want it to be essentialized to just something that came from the West, because it's so much more than that. Yeah.
I said maybe sounds like she was feeling upset that maybe she assumed like there wasn't a recognition of the ownership that the Vietnamese artist took with that song. Her name is Vo Can, right?
Yeah, the singer Vo Can is a man. Yeah.
Oh, excuse me. Yeah, I wonder if that's what it was about. And I think it sounds like there's just like a lot of banning. How do I articulate that? What is your relationship like to music when your country is like constantly banning different kinds of music? And what does that communicate to you at a young age?
Yeah. Yeah.
And the red music, you were talking, it's anti-revolutionary. You're speaking about like the communist revolution?
Yeah, it's the red music is pro-communist revolution.
Okay.
Yeah. And I actually looked it up because I was curious on YouTube, and they have, their music has hella views. There's like compilations of red music and there's like millions of views, but it's very like gung-ho and also has a war-like aspect to it. And even like the South Vietnamese music that was war-like, that was also banned. So on both sides, there was like war, very like war-driven music.
Yeah.
And I actually hated those parts in Paris by Night, because it was just like all of a sudden you have all these like beautiful dancing and like love, and all of a sudden there's this song and all these men are dressed up in army uniforms, and I'm just like, why are we doing this? I was like bringing stuff up for my parents in the middle of all the fun stuff, and I was just like, why are they doing this?
Yeah, it's like re-traumatizing.
Yeah.
Yeah, like why? That's a great question.
Yeah.
And then would you guys have conversations about those parts, or just everyone would be quiet? Or
yeah, everyone would be quiet, we don't talk about it.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. And then earlier you were speaking about the yellow music, about Kingoi Jam, that's the indigenous groups in Vietnam, right?
Yeah,
Cham folks.
Yeah, and they were, South Vietnam basically colonized that area, and the song is Hung Do Bang. That's the name of the song. I forgot which sort of leader, which leader banned that, but they banned it.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Oh, go ahead. You got it.
I was going to ask, like, how do you engage with music now? And like, how do you bring your upbringing into it?
Oh my gosh. Okay, so I'm studying at the Beat Junkies Institute of Sound, which is the best DJ school ever. It's in Southern California, and it's taught by the legendary Beat Junkie crew. My teachers are Babu, Mr. Chalk, so just super legendary DJs. And the staff there is just incredible, just everyone's super kind and giving. But my relationship to music now that I'm a DJ is very different. are in some ways and then very similar in other ways. Like when I was growing up, I moved around a lot. I would spend all of my Saturdays by myself in my room, like just ripping music from LimeWire and like looking for new music and then organizing my iTunes playlist. And just so in that way, I feel like it's very similar. I'm not ripping music anymore, but the sound quality is just awful actually. And but I am like, now that I started DJing, I have to like get so much music, but I have like way more music than I can consume. So and I've learned that's actually like a really natural part of being a DJ, is just you just have more music than you'll ever probably listen to. So I'm in a saturation of music and I go to a lot of live DJ gigs. And yeah, recently I've been really wanting silence. Maybe that's why I was feeling funky before a call. I'm like, I think I just want some silence. How do I bring my upbringing into my music? Yeah, I think something I've been thinking about, I did my first DJ gig ever and I played like a lot of 2000s R&B, which I'm super into, just like Mariah Carey and like Aaliyah and Ja Rule. And I also played like a lot of Sade because I think like I love Sade because of my mom. And yeah, so I think my upbringing is just my mom's taste has really influenced mine. And yeah, and I think just like my constant hunger for more music is also really similar to my upbringing. Yeah, I don't know.
No, that's beautiful. I like that you're saturated in more music than you can consume. I think of course, take your breaks as you need and get the silence. But that's such like a beautiful problem to have.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's a beautiful problem. And like, it's funny because like, I think in my 20s and then all my friends are, not all of them, a lot of my friends are also in their 20s. But it's really interesting to see how people are choosing to spend their money, because like everyone is starting to work more seriously. And like some people are like, my best friend's super into tattoos, and other people are really into luxurious going out, fancy restaurants, that kind of thing. And I'm just pouring my money into music.
Do you have a like, how do you, what kind of music, what do you buy, like the MP3, like the audio, do you have like discs, or what, how do you buy them?
Yeah, thank you for asking. I started signing up to record pools, so I'm in the Soul and the Horn record pool, the Beat Junkies record pool, and I go crate digging a lot, so I buy a lot of vinyl, and like I buy the 12 inches, and then I also buy the 45s. So the 12 inches are the big ones, and then the 45s are the little ones. And yeah, I think the other thing about music recently is I've been thinking about horns more, trumpets and saxophones and brass horns, because of the Soul and the Horn party that I go to on Fridays. It's on Twitch, and Natasha Diggs runs it with like Dee Prosper, Lenny Love, and, or not Lenny Love, excuse me, Lenny. Lenny Love is the Vietnamese DJ. Do you know about Lenny Love? Okay, no. She's a Vietnamese DJ. So she did a Twitch stream on New Year's, and it was really interesting. She was like talking about the history while she would play. And then they also did an Ao Yai fashion show.
That's dope.
Yeah, she's pretty cool. She's pretty cool. So I've been also thinking about a lot of horns and music, and just trying to find, because usually a lot of hip-hop DJs will look for drums, because drums are really good to scratch with, and then they're also like just like the core of hip-hop and so many other music. But yeah, I've been thinking about the horns. What's your relationship to music going on right now?
I don't know how to play any instruments or nothing. I don't like create music at all. I just listen to music, so I don't know that much. Yeah, I think I made a playlist compiling like Southeast Asian psych funk soul rock on Spotify, and somehow it magically amassed like 1,000-something followers, and that was wild to me. And oh yeah, you were talking about records, and I don't know, I think it'd be really cool to go to Vietnam and try to look for like old records.
Oh my god, I actually had tried. Okay, so I googled record stores in Vietnam. There's three, or what? Maybe they just aren't on the internet and you have to know someone to know where it is, but we should do that together. I would totally be down to do that with you. But it's interesting, do you think the record stores in Vietnam would be pressing their own like Vietnamese music, like a lot of it, or do you think it's like, what we're saying about the music is really just influenced by other people?
I have no idea. I don't know if records are a thing over in Vietnam right now. Like the way it is here, I think people are like really into records. But I know I was following this blog from Vietnam, the Saigonier and the Urbanist out of Hanoi. And they were sharing that this guy was able to track down a bunch of old Vietnamese music and remaster it. And he made a compilation called Saigon Super Sound. And the second one has already come out. It's been a while. And that was the first time where I was like, oh, wow, this is like how old music can sound. And there was a lot of like funk and rock to it. But I don't know how much like Vietnamese people in Vietnam are attached to the older music, especially when it was banned. I'm assuming they stopped banning it. That sort of gap in music history, I wonder what that does to like the new music.
Yeah, I'm learning about all these music as you're saying it. And I just Googled Saigon Supersound and it's by this German DJ called Jan Hagen. I hope my German is still good.
Did you ever German?
Yeah, I took 3 years of German.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah, but it's like totally gone now, probably.
Yeah, this guy's not Vietnamese and he made this compilation. And like when I found out about Saigon Supersound, it led me down this rabbit hole of compilations of old music from other countries. And that's how I made my little playlist. So I don't know like how much Vietnamese people here and Vietnamese people in Vietnam, what I don't know what their relationship is to old music. But I do know that something I'm trying to do in my relationship to music currently is to try to have more karaoke parties.
Yes. And, like,
sing Viet music with my friends or otherwise.
He has Vietnamese daughters.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
maybe he married a Vietnamese woman because it says, so this is from the Saigonier. It says, his initial intention in making Saigon Supersound, he explains, was to expose parts of Vietnamese culture and history to foreigners, second and third generation Viet Kieu, like his daughters.
Oh, well,
that's really sweet.
Yeah, I'm a second, I guess, second gen Viet Kieus too, so... Yeah, I guess he did a good job. I played some of the music for my aunt and then she liked it for sure. Yeah,
that's cool. I'll definitely have to cop that.
Yeah, I tried buying the record. I think they're sold out. But
oh, damn.
I want to hear people mix like old Viet music into.
Yeah, that's really interesting because Lonnie Love always does these videos where she's like, Viet songs you should know about Viet rap. And you and I have spoken about how like... You guys, we've talked a little bit about Viet rap before and it's disappointing sometimes. But yeah, I don't hear old Viet songs. That'd be interesting. Maybe I'll try to do that.
I was looking up Lonnie Love right now. Definitely, like, I want to hear your music even without the Vietnamese influence. Yeah, it'd be really cool. Oh, I like her website. It's quite nice.
You guys should check out Thao's Southeast Asian Psych Funk. It's a playlist on Spotify. It's so good.
I never promoted it or anything. I don't post it anywhere.
I just get followers. People just love me.
I think there are other psych funk playlists, but like from like specific countries. And I think, yeah, I don't know why they have a lot of followers. So I guess people are really looking for that stuff.
Dude, I'm looking for psych funk. Like I copped some records. Let me go get them. I'll show you right now.
I'm going to go get my records. So I have a record player that I got off of Freecycle. So it's super low quality and I should probably get it. It doesn't even have a speaker. I was like doing that thing where like I tried to build like a little horn or cone from foil and attach a needle. But like my friend came and they like showed me how to hook things up to like a receiver and all this stuff. But it's still really old and low quality. So I only have like really not many records. So like when I have more money and time, I'll probably get a legit record player. But these are the three records I want to highlight. First up is The Carpenter, A Song for You. I guess like when it comes to like Western music, my mom loves The Carpenters. And I heard a Vietnamese cover of Top of the World once in the one where they did it of all songs from other countries. So yeah, I have The Carpenters. And I saw this at a thrift store, but it's Julio Iglesias.
That's so good.
Yeah. And yeah, he has Abrazame in here, which I know. And Hey, also Vietnamese cover of that. And then this one, this is Nguyen Yao Canon singing in China, Vietnam, and Laos.
Whoa.
I haven't been able to listen to it because of how bad my record player is.
I will personally fund your record player.
Yeah, I saw this online. I think this company, Sublime Frequencies, they have a lot of interesting records on their website. Because I've seen other, yeah, I was just trying to look for like records of music from Vietnam. And then I found this website, but then I also saw it at a record store. So I think this one's kind of new. Yeah, so those are the three. What about yours? What did you bring?
I think this is funk. This is Jimmy Cliff's The Harder They Come.
It does look funk. It looks hella funk. Yes.
And then this one is Music from the Land of the Rising Sun.
Ooh.
Which looked really rad. I think it's a Japanese record.
Yeah. Do you like Japanese city pop?
I don't think I've listened to a lot of it.
Really?
That's why I think I wanted to start listening to Japanese records, because like the Beat Junkies are always talking about how ill Japanese records are.
Dude, I love Japanese city pop. Do you know that song Baby Powder by Genevieve or Out of Time by The Weeknd?
No.
They all sampled Japanese city pop. I mean, I'm sure there's hella other songs that sample Japanese city pop, but
oh my god, send me more.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, can you compile all the Vietnamese people you mentioned today? Because I don't know how to spell.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. I'm all trying to search it up and then I realize I can't read it right.
Oh yes. I'm sorry. I will.
No, you're fine. And then this is Francis's Bebe Psychedelic Stanza.
Ooh. That's cool.
And then this is, I guess I realize I only have two psychedelics. And then this is World Psychedelic Classics number 3, a compilation. So I didn't really know the hype about compilations because you put me onto compilations and I started to get more curious about it. So I got this record. This is called Love's a Real Thing, the Funky Fuzzy Sounds of West Africa.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, because I used to think compilations felt like, I don't know, I always feel kind of weird about compilations and anthologies because I'm like, I want to read or listen to the entire thing, like the entire album by the original artist, or like I want to read the entire book of the original author. So I always thought like compilations or anthologies were funky to me, but maybe they're not. Maybe they're together for a reason.
Yeah. I love compilations. That makes me think of like books, because like it's so hard for me to finish one big book. But if there's a book that has several chapters or they have a common theme, but you could read them independently, then I could totally do that.
I see. It helps you like chunk it out a little bit more.
Yeah. And I feel like compilations really allow you to see the atmosphere outside of that artist alone. Who were their peers at the time?
Oh, that's really interesting.
Yeah.
That's very good.
That's why I like compilations.
I want to see if we have time for this. We could wrap up soon. So I actually feel like we reached a lot of our questions. But something you were talking earlier about diasporas and like music from abroad. I've been reading Paul Gilroy's The Black Atlantic, Modernity and the Doubled Consciousness. And I'm on the chapter about Black music and the politics of authenticity. And it's called Jewels Brought from Bondage. And then there's a question I think could help us think about what we're talking about now, which is, how are we to think critically about artistic products and aesthetic codes, which though they may be traceable back to one distinct location, have been changed either by the passage of time or by their displacement, relocation, or dissemination through the networks of communication and cultural exchange?
Oh, that's beautiful. I like that question.
That's good, huh?
Yeah.
And then there's a few more that we could pose. Obviously, this is all within the context of Black music and also the history of slavery in the US, but I'll read a bunch of questions now. This is on page 75. My main concern in this chapter is less with the formal attributes of these syncretic expressive cultures than with the problem of how critical, evaluative, axiological, anti-aesthetic judgments on them can be made, and with the place of ethnicity and authenticity within these judgments. What special analytical problems arise if a style, genre, or particular performance of music is identified as being expressive of the absolute essence of the group that produced it? What contradictions appear in the transmission and adaptation of cultural expression by other diasporic populations, and how will they be resolved? How does the hemispheric displacement and global dissemination of Black music get reflected in localized traditions of critical writing? And once the music is perceived as a world phenomenon, what value is placed upon its origins, particularly if they come into opposition against further mutations produced during its contingent loops and fractal trajectories? And then I think this is the last question. Where music is thought to be emblematic and constitutive of racial difference rather than just associated with it, how is music used to specify general issues pertaining to the problem of racial authenticity and the consequent self-identity of the ethnic group? Like, what?
Those are great questions.
So good.
Have you read Paul Gilroy's work before? Have you been introduced to Paul Gilroy before?
Yeah, I read, I think, the first chapter.
I only just heard about Paul Gilroy these past 2 weeks because I was listening to a podcast, one of my favorite podcasts, The Fire in These Times, and they featured William C. Anderson, who was talking about Black anarchism. And he talked about Paul Gilroy and how Paul Gilroy's work influenced the way that he came to Black anarchism. And that was really cool that you brought this into it. And that also made me think of how, like, for Vietnam being like a, when the communists won and they banned yellow music, did they know that a lot of quote unquote Western music that influenced Vietnamese music, like funk, soul rock, that comes from Black and brown folks? And it's not just like a Western thing. It's not like a white thing. It's much more complicated than that. And yeah, that makes me think of it too. All the questions he posed, it does raise so many contradictions about the way that we think about Nhạc Khai Hoài or like Vietnamese music that has influences outside of Vietnam.
Yeah. I wonder about how, like, your mom has felt like the music that you guys were debating about felt like it was part of a Vietnamese identity, the covers.
Yeah, like, it's part of her identity. But it does complicate it because it's they take it as their own, but also there's an origin to it that isn't talked about.
Yeah, I think maybe that's the difference, is, like, how do we have ownership over things and then also talk about where they come from?
Yeah.
And then also talk about what's complicated about us wanting ownership over something, and then what's created when we have ownership over something, like how you're like, oh, sometimes I think the Vietnamese version is better. What's created through that, that, like, people were able to create their own versions of these songs?
Yeah. What are your answers to those questions?
Where's my notebook? Actually, I've been journaling about them. I think some of the things I was thinking about is considering the context of slavery. And, like, for Black diasporic people who were enslaved, that music has a great cultural impact. But also considering now people who make music, like, what the responsibility is of the cultural impact of the music you're making, and then understanding the history of where it's coming from, and considering the roots of resistance and survival and expression, like, during the slavery era, which I think can also be considered, like, to think about also, like, for Vietnamese people, the roots of war and colonization and also survival and other aspects too.
Yeah, definitely.
Because sometimes some of the Vietnamese rap, I feel like, are you making music, like, responsibly? Yeah, that's, like, a little bit of my critique of Vietnamese rap. Not all of it. Some of it is very powerful. Like, I actually think some of Sue Boy's rap is very powerful storytelling.
Yeah, I'm having a lot of thoughts on this.
Yeah, and then also for us too to consider, like, the music that is created. I mean, some of the music obviously is not all covers. Like, some of our music is from Vietnam and rooted in our histories and stuff, but just to consider, like, that it was created in a transnational and, like, global way. And so the impacts of that are so different. And, like, the relationship to that music is so different too.
Yeah. I think when you were reading the questions, the last one, it was talking about what does it say about the origin or something like that. And I guess it doesn't make sense to me to see music as coming from just one country. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's just, even if we talk about Vietnamese food, it just has influence from so many other places. Music is the same. And you can say this not just about Vietnam, but almost every country.
Yeah, and I also wonder, you know how you were like, oh, this version is, like, better than the original. I almost feel like that's almost a way of honoring the roots, is that you're prepared to do right by the song and sing it super well and play it super well. That's, like, an honoring in and of itself that the song gets another version of it, I think.
Yeah, because the act of, like, when covers are made, they have to change the lyrics almost entirely, because it's not a direct, it's in no way a direct translation, or it would be horrible. And so the artistry that goes not just into singing the song, but writing the new lyrics too, that takes a lot of work and creativity.
Yeah, that's a labor of love.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not really talked about, though.
We talked about it.
I don't know if you know the song New Person, Same Old Mistakes by Tame Impala. And then Rihanna covered it and did with a new title, Same Old Mistakes. And I got into this, like, I was talking to someone, they're like, I like the original Tame Impala version better, because Ariana does is just like the same, like everything is the same except the voice is different because it's her singing it. And I'm just like, I kind of like the Rihanna version better. Even though it's like the exact same, the only difference is it's her voice. I noticed there was like one word that was different in the lyrics, and it didn't make a huge difference, but
that's a different song then. One word was different.
Yeah, one word was different. The singer's different. And I think it's different for her to sing it. Like, it's a different like energy and vibe to it.
Like, yeah, and there's like different context, like, because Rihanna has her own history and her own background and her own cultural experiences.
Yeah.
Because Tame Impala just, I don't know why, just reminds me of like Forever 21. Like, that's like the music that would play while you're shopping at Forever 21.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's one thing for the Beatles to say, "And I love her," over and over. And then Wukan's like spitting a whole like poetic thing.
Oh my God. Because Vietnamese, I'm sure the translation in Vietnamese is amazing. Because Vietnamese people are so poetic.
They are.
Like, so poetic. Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny to me that like Vietnamese music doesn't sound at all like how Vietnamese people talk. Like, kind of poetic, and then like when Vietnamese folks talk, it's like very like blunt.
Yes, that's why I was so surprised when I started listening to Vietnamese music, and then like I also started trying to read a little bit more and ask my parents like for translation. It's, oh wow, that's so beautiful. What's wrong with us? He speaks so like frank, but I guess there's nothing wrong with that. It's just funny, the juxtaposition.
Yeah. It's great though.
All right, thank you so much for listening. We'll leave you to ponder about those questions. Apex Express is a proud member of Asian Americans for Civil Rights and Equality, and you can find out more at acre.org. You're tuned into Apex Express Radio, 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, and online at kpfa.org. Thank you so much, Thao, for joining me in Viet Unity and sharing so much love and joy and music. And if you want to grow alongside us, join us today. You can follow Viet Unity
Bay Area, I think. Viet Unity Bay Area.
Yes, you could definitely find out more about Viet Unity at acre.org. That's acre.org. And thank you so much to the listeners in the Bay Area and beyond. Let's continue to organize and get free together. Apex Express is produced by Mika Lee, Jolina Kian Lee, and Paige Chung. Tonight's show was produced by me, Paige Chung. And thank you so much also to Thao for all of the writing that was done to create the questions for the show. And thank you to the team at kpfa.org for their support. Have a great night.
This is a community announcement. You can join the Tony Award-winning San Francisco Mime Troupe as it opens for its 63rd season of free shows with their 2022 show, Back to the Way Things Were. Middle-aged liberals Ralph and Alice wistfully yearn for the before time when things seemed normal. Back to the Way Things Were is performed in the characteristic and unique singing and dancing political style of the San Francisco Mime Troupe. Performances take place in Bay Area parks through September 5th. For a complete schedule or more information, visit sfmt.org or call 415-285-1717. The community calendar is produced by the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Please send your wheelchair accessible listing to calendar@kpfa.org. To hear this information again, call 510-848-6767, extension 621, or view it online at kpfa.org.
Lettucey.
It happens all the time like this. That one person will be right there. And she was just crying. All right. We were getting ready to sing. All right. I hadn't even got the words out. She was already in it. And her eye, she was not too far away, but I just had to tell her to come here. And I held her hand and sang. And I said, see, I had a bad day. I've been performing and I got it all out. And I forget what I do. See, you better remember.
Right.
This is why you're doing it. You belong here to do this. This is your calling, is to ignite something in people, to make them, let them know that they belong too. It's bigger than me. It always has been bigger than me.
KPFA, storytelling for social change.
This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, and 88.1 KFCF in Fresno.